Baby, it is that deep for you. It is that deep for you, and that's okay. It's okay that you feel things so deeply. It is okay that things land so hard for you, and I'm sorry. I'm sorry that you are surrounded by people who don't know how to hold your softness. I'm sorry that you're surrounded by people who don't know how to hold your tenderness. I'm sorry that you are surrounded by people who invalidate just how big and soft and mushy you are. And it is that deep. And I want you to lean into that depth of the way that you feel life. It is that deep for you, and that's okay.
Has anybody ever told you that maybe your problem is you got too much ambition? Like, you could just go to parties and chill the fuck out. You don't have to, like, rattle off your whole resume. Like, you could just walk up to a group of people and be like, inchworms are so cute, right? Like, the cutest cuties!
For everybody that says,
oh, I could spend all my time with my significant other. They'll never get on my nerves. Nah, nah, nah.
That's a fucking lie. Because this man right here...
Baby, I love you so much. We're gonna get buried next to each other. I love this man.
But he has a very special talent of finding my last fucking nerve and tap dancing on it.
I got 7 kids.
I'm their daddy now.
I don't like to clean.
I love dirty bitches.
I smack the shit out you.
We gonna fight.
I'm a hoe.
I'm a pimp.
I'm broke.
I got bread.
I'm homeless.
You can live with me.
My titties hang low.
I like chocolate udders.
I don't like to cook.
Ramen noodle.
Fuck you.
Win.
I've invented something. Cool. What is it? I invented a cup. Oh, those actually already exist. No, it's like a really good cup that's basically indestructible. Come on, indestructible. Yeah, a lady once had one in her car during a fire and her car was completely demolished, but the cup was fine. There was even still ice inside. Wow. Wow, indeed. We even offer a lifetime warranty on these cups because that's how indestructible they are. That's actually very cool that you've created a product people truly only need to buy one, maybe two of in their lifetime, helping to offset the negative impact of consumerism. Oh, no, we want to be a part of consumerism. What? Yeah, when we were marketing to workers, we were making a meager $73 million a year, and then we thought, what if we market to influencers? Now we're making upwards of $750 million a year. Market to influencers how? Well, first we got on mommy blogger lists as a must-have product. Oh, okay, that's not so bad. I could see how moms would want a practical product like that. And then that was our gateway into having our products become a symbol of status and popularity, so everybody felt like they needed to have one.
Oh, no.
Oh, yes. And then we created a bunch of different colors and patterns so people were inspired to build a huge collection.
Why would anyone ever need a huge collection of those cups?
They don't. That's the point. We weren't making as much money when people were only buying one or two, and now that people feel like they need dozens, we're making so much more.
But what happens when people get rid of their old cups to make way for new cups, and then there's just a whole bunch of your indestructible cups hanging out in landfills?
That's not really our problem. But isn't one of your company missions to help build a more sustainable, less disposable life?
It sure is.
Anyways, did you see the absolute frenzy over our limited edition cups?
Of course you're making limited edition cups. Wow, this can't get worse.
Yeah, we did a collaboration with Starbucks.
It just got worse.
If you are thinking about going back to school, please fucking listen to this so that you don't get screwed, okay? There are two different types, and I'm talking about, like, beyond high school, secondary education shit. There are two different types of institutions you can go to. A for-profit institution or a not-for-profit institution. State schools, community colleges, the majority of private universities are all not-for-profit institutions, meaning they are funded and kept open by state funding, federal funding, tuition, their sports teams. A lot of times they have like a sister hospital, so somewhere like Wake Forest, it is a private school, but the hospital generates a lot of money for them. Alumni donations, they have multiple, a fuck ton of sources of income so that the school can then stay open and offer a quality education. A for-profit institution, so anything that you've seen a commercial for, Grand Canyon University, ITT Tech, Phoenix Online, or places that offer like certification training. So cosmetology, culinary arts, welding, shit like that. Lots of times, those are for-profit institutions. The only way that those schools make money is off of the tuition of their students. So they are extraordinarily predatory. They go after non-traditional students, meaning, hey, single mom, I know your child is fucking taking a nap and you already have 3 jobs, but while you have 15 minutes of silence, log online and work towards a degree and a better life. Fuck out of here, okay? Hang on. Okay, the reason that for-profit schools are oftentimes very attractive to people who, non-traditional students, minority students, etc., is because often they offer 19 different degree tracks. You can come 3 days a week, you can come 5 days a week, you can come on the nights, you can come on the weekends, you can work at your own pace. Cool. If you're offering me all that different shit, am I sure that I'm gonna get a quality education regardless of which course I choose? Can you guarantee that? Show me the stats and facts. Oftentimes, a for-profit school has a damn near 100% acceptance rate, meaning if you can take out a bank loan, you're accepted into the school because it is owned. A for-profit school has an owner. It is a business. Their number one concern is not education. It's a return for their shareholders. And that is what your tuition is. And that is what your loan is. It's a return to go pad somebody's pockets, not yours. These schools are predatory because often they heavily recruit low-income students because these students qualify for financial aid. So they make money off of you. They're making money off of the poor, basically, is what that means and what that translates to. They do not have to answer to any kind of accreditation agency. And they, pardon me, yes, they do. But they are always a national accrediting agency. A state school is going to be nationally and regionally accredited. So let's say fucking Grand Canyon University has, you know, this national accredited whatever the fuck. If you were to stop your schooling there and want to transfer those credits, fuck you. Not a single one of those credits are transferring because every other institution that is not for profit knows that this is a fucking business. This is not a school. They just took your money. That's all that is. I know this sounds a little harsh, but I'm just being honest because these people fuck you of your money and they do not offer you a quality education. Say, hypothetically, there is a culinary school, right? That is a for-profit certification program. They say, yep, we offer you all your materials, this, this, and this, in order to be eligible to get your, to finish the program. You have to show us that you have mastered the skills of dicing and mincing. Here are 3 apples. You have to show us that you've perfected the skill 200 times in your journey at the school. Here's 3 apples. How the fuck do you expect me to show that I have perfected mincing and dicing if you haven't even given me the proper fucking tools that I need? But the reason you haven't given me the proper tools that I need is because the tuition that I'm paying is going to a shareholder. It's going to whoever this owner is. In a not-for-profit school, a community college, a state school, fucking anything else, all of the money that you pay in tuition, all of the money that they generate from sports and everything else is generated back into the school so that you are given a quality education, so that their degree is seen as, oh shit, all right, very good, when you enter the workplace. A lot of time, people who graduate from a for-profit school, they get fucked when they're in the, once they enter like the job force and the work field. Because employers see a degree from Grand Canyon University or see a degree from ITT Tech, and they understand that essentially the product that is being sold by this company, and the company is fucking Phoenix Online, the product that they're selling is your degree. So this degree essentially don't mean shit. Please be extremely fucking weary of for-profit schools, of for-profit certification programs. Ask a million questions. What is their acceptance rate? If it is in the 90s or 100s, that's a red fucking flag. Why is everybody getting let in? Because everybody can take out a bank loan. The things that you need in order to apply or be approved to apply to one of these types of schools is simply a GED. Or a college degree, or excuse me, a high school diploma. In a not-for-profit school, they're gonna say, all right, sick, you got your college diploma, what kind of grades did you even make? I know you got your diploma, but... are you a piece of shit student? Or, yeah, I know you got your diploma and you also have a felony offense for sexual assault. And I know that this school is 98% women. You said you were eligible for financial aid? Congratulations, you're accepted into school. They are a fucking scam. And they are padding the pockets of some fucking business owner, and they're getting rich off of poor people who can take out loans. The majority of these people will fucking default on their loans, which means I'm taking out a $30,000 loan. I have 5 years to pay that shit back. In 5 years, if I can't pay that shit back, bitch, the government's getting their money one way or another. You ain't getting no tax return. They're garnishing your fucking wages. Your credit's in the toilet. They fuck you forever. Not only will you not be able to find a job, you also are about to be in worse shape than you were before you even tried to better your fucking life. But they don't tell you this shit. They don't... like, fuck politics. At this point, it's not even about that. It's about, hey, probably stop fucking the poor. I guess. Obviously. And if you say you're going to offer a good... you know what I'm saying? You talking about, oh, we're the Michelin star of welding. We're the MIT of welding. We're the Cornell of culinary arts. That's cool. Yale, Princeton, and Stanford have a 1-teacher-to-5-student ratio. In terms of the national accrediting agency for these cosmetology programs that are for profit, the ratio must not exceed 30-1. 30 students to one. And you're trying to compare yourself? You're trying to tell me that you're the fucking... the Princeton of a ponytail? Bitch, Princeton only has 5 students to 1 teacher. You have 30 to 1 teacher. This is not a quality fucking education for 30 racks. Fuck out of my face. Anyway, educate yourself, bitch. Don't take out... I hope this was helpful. I have a lot of sources and shit, and I've been doing a lot of research on this, and I plan on making, like, a long, like, 10-minute YouTube video. You remember when they used to do, like, finance for dummies? This is gonna be fucking secondary education for dickheads, because I feel like a lot of this shit is, like, 911-ish that we need to know it, but the language is so hoity-toit that fuck it, just whatever. You know what I mean? But, like, let me break that shit down to you the way I'm talking to you right now, so that we cannot get fucked by these big wigs who are just in it for the money. Y'all have a good day.
I'm here to talk about the not so unique experience, unfortunately, of, you know, growing up not thinking that you're going to grow up. Thinking that you're not gonna reach adulthood, and thus not planning for it. Like, everyone around you is like, oh, I wanna be this when I grow up, I wanna be this when I grow up. And you're like, I'm not growing up, so I don't really wanna be anything. And then you do grow up, and then you get there, somehow. You're alive, I'm proud of you. But then you have to make a bunch of decisions about your career and your future really, really fast in order to be on the same track as everyone else. First of all, you don't need to be on the same track as everyone else. You don't need to. You don't need to have it all figured out. But I understand why you feel that way, because I felt that way too. It's tough. I experienced autistic burnout. I started the early stages of it at around 16, which coincidentally was when I started college. It peaked at around 17, and then I've been trying to rebuild things ever since then. It's been rough. But anyway, I've changed my major 3 times, and I don't think that I'm supposed to be in college, but I've spent so much time and money being in college that I can't just stop. I have to finish it, unfortunately. So here I am. What I really want to do is be an actor. But you know, you tell anybody that and they're like, okay, so you're gonna work in a grocery store for the rest of your life? And it's like, well, I guess so. Because there's genuinely no other job that I could ever see myself doing. The acting, not grocery stores. All of this to say that you're not alone. Whatever led you to this point where you're, you know, in an unexpected age and you need to actually start planning for a future that, you know, you only recently started seeing, you don't need to rush through these decisions. You are not falling behind. You're fine. You're gonna do good. and you're going to figure out what you need, and you're going to get the things that you need, and it'll be okay eventually. You're going to go far. No con. And you're not alone. This is something that a lot of us experience, unfortunately, especially in our generation. You got this. You can do this. I mean, I'm proud of you.
This is to all the white makeup influencers about the Juvia's Place blush. It's not for you, because you already have everything. Everything is for you.
I find it real hilarious that people only care about inclusivity when it only pertains to them, when it only affects them. Yet when black people have been exclaiming up and down that most brands are not inclusive towards us, you expect us to sit there and be quiet. Okay. And since we're talking about Juvia's Place and I'm their number one fan, I thought about doing a full face of Juvia's Place while talking about the history of the brand. Well, almost. I ain't got everything, but I got the mass majority. Let's get started. First, I'm going to start off with the Juvia's Place I Am Magic Natural Radiance Foundation in the shade Angola. When I say this stuff is pigmented, you're probably only going to need this much. Juvia's Place was founded in 2016 by Chichi Iburu. And the reason why she created the brand was because that she saw a major gap within the beauty industry. While shopping for makeup for herself, she noticed that a plethora of these large, major makeup companies did not cater to people who look like us. If anything, these larger makeup companies expected us to just use the stuff that they offer to us, even though it was not broad enough for us. And rightfully so, Chichi got fed up. So Chichi wanted to start her own makeup business. There was just one little small issue. Bitch, she was broke. She had no damn money. Like, she had two kids, a son and a daughter. She really did not have the funds to start this brand. She had no investors. She literally had nothing. Nobody to help her to start this brand. So Chichi really said, fuck it, no bars, and used her last $2,000 to create Juvia's Place. At first, she started off with brushes, because she knew that was going to be the easiest way to start in the market. And once she made enough sales from those brushes, she then created the Nubian palette. Also, by the way, notice how I only put two small dots, and that's all I needed for one cheek? Some of y'all be heavy-handed. The less the better. And rightfully so, that product went viral. And from then on out, Juvia's Place was born. Also, segue, can we talk about this blush? Leave it to a black woman to create a bubblegum pink blush for dark-skinned people that shows up bubblegum pink. Thank you. Use a purple. I don't fucking want to. Thanks. Anywho, besides the point, that drive and determination that Chichi had is the reason why people like me finally have the inclusivity that we needed. Hell, without Chichi's determination, I never would have got my favorite blushes. The blush rouges, we left her down. So the reason why Juvia's Place came to be is because there was an extreme gap in the beauty space. A gap that these multi-million dollar companies refused to fill. And instead of Chichi complaining that these brands weren't making products for her, she made it her damn self. So I'm just a little bit bewildered and confused as to seeing a bunch of people saying that Juvia's Place is way too pigmented, even though I find the pigmentation of her products to be just fine. And I find it quite funny that most people only care about inclusivity when it personally affects them. But black and brown folk have been complaining about the lack of inclusivity with these major companies, but then y'all sit there and do nothing. Y'all don't speak for us. But let this one black-owned brand cater to black people because they haven't been catered to for eons, and now y'all want to scream bloody murder. The makeup industry has catered to y'all for centuries, and history can prove that. Like, oh wow, this one brand doesn't cater to you. You have like at least 50 others that will. I, on the other hand, and people who look like me, don't have that luxury. There are not many brands inside a drugstore who make products that cater to us and also look great on us. And if they do, they only have a foundation and concealer, and that's all they want to carry for us and expect us to be happy with that alone. Especially me being dark-skinned with an olive undertone, most brands don't even think I fucking exist. So Chichi made the brand to keep us in mind and make sure that we were first in line. Literally, if you look at how she lists her foundation and concealers, the darker shades are first and the lighter shades are last. Because she obviously wants to make darker skinned people the top priority. By the way, this gloss, the candy shop gloss and the shade bubblegum? Yes. So I'm sorry that this one black owned brand that specifically caters to darker skinned people does not work for you. You can go use the other 50 to 60 brands inside of Sephora or Ulta that caters to you. Let us have this one. Or if you really want to use the product so bad, be less fucking heavy-handed. And I just want to take time out of my day to say thank you to Chi-Chi. You literally took the last dollars that you had to your name and created an empire for all of us to enjoy. And you constantly come out with bomb products and make sure that we are the ones that you're catering to first. And I got nothing but respect for a person who does that. Anyway, this is what you could look like if you used Juvia's Place correctly. Yeah? Yeah, okay. Glad we had that talk. Love you down. See you later.
I just saw a video of The Rock getting booed at like WWE Las Vegas, and it was very interesting, right? His facial expression got me the most because it was very calm and collected, but it also gave a hint of defeat, especially because we know that The Rock is a very prideful man who portrays himself to be a hero in everything that he does. And it's truly interesting because I remember when I was little, when I first came to America, I learned about The Rock through WWE, and ever since then I loved them. In every and any movie that I saw him in, he played the good guy, except for in The Mummy. I hadn't even realized it was him at the time, but he played the good guy. And it was really nice to see such a big, strong, masculine man want to be the protector of everything and everyone. Truly, and not only that, he was really funny. I love seeing his skits with Kevin Hart. I thought they were really funny, and I just really liked the whole energy and vibe that he gave off. But that started fading for me as I grew up and really started despising celebrities for just the whole culture, all the money, all of that stuff that they do. And because I started disregarding celebrities, I disregarded him too. It's like, no beef, I just don't really care for celebrities, including him. And to be fair, like I said, I think a lot of people were going through this kind of like, I don't really want to do celebrities anymore, celebrities are not it. But the true detachment to The Rock came with the Maui fires. When he and Oprah came on our timeline and our For You pages and begged the poor for money to help Maui, that's when people were like, oh man, fuck that guy. And then we found out that Oprah had land that seemed to be fine. No fire had touched that land. And in addition to that, we already knew that The Rock was pulling some sketchy strings behind the scenes of everything that he does. And that came to light too. So people had multiple reasons not to like either of them. But The Rock smiling in our faces and telling us what we could use the money for and all of that stuff just really broke it to a lot of people that he was just not that guy. And perhaps at the time he didn't realize it, perhaps when he was getting the backlash, it didn't click for him. But I think when he was getting booed at WWE in Las Vegas, it clicked then. Because when the people were booing, they were also chanting something that people said was Maui. So they were booing and chanting Maui. I'm not necessarily too sure if it was Maui, but if it was, The Rock's reaction just looks slowly like defeated, because you spent all this money and time curating this picture of you as the hero, but now that everybody knows you're doing the dirty work, there's no coming back from that. And I think he understood then and there that this is just the beginning of the end for all of them.
Wilbur admitted to biting his ex-girlfriend, being a slob, and being weird. Released a 2-page statement just saying that yes, everything is true. She would be stranded for days at his house with no real way to get out. The biting that we already talked about, to where she would be in pain. Being in a dumpster pile and expecting her to clean it up, and just a bunch of other just really awful things. Teamsy went all the way off on him. And you started this by defending yourself, by claiming you've changed, you make it about you. You left the most simple yet most important thing for last. And apology. Even then, your apology isn't an apology. You left it out for any pain I caused, which lacks any accountability. Brooke from 100 Thieves spoke out too. People are allowed to revoke consent at any time. No accountability equals shit apology. Bamboo went in too, saying anyone who tries to downplay or discredit a victim's story for any reason, especially for the sake of being able to watch a creator's content, is an idiot. Support victims before anything else, always. XGG, shame on you. This apology itself is a void to the truth and is so incredibly shallow and self-centered. I will be posting a full video going in more in depth about everything, but just know in that video, I will not be referring to these as allegations, because now Wilbur admitted it and it is the truth, and he is getting slapped around on Twitter, honestly, as he deserved in my opinion.
Why are all of these places hiring, but like, won't fucking hire.
Well over 3,000 jobs. That is the lowball estimate of how many jobs in total I've applied to since I graduated college in the winter of 2021. Statistically, job openings on the market are at an all-time high. Why does it feel like it's absolutely impossible to get a job right now? Well, I'm about to tell you why. Because no, I never even managed to actually find a way into the industry in which I graduated from and wanted to join. In fact, it's so hard for Gen Z and millennials to get a job nowadays that even when I did finally get a job, after like 8-9 months of applying, I continued to apply to jobs. Because I knew that's literally how hard it is to get a job. That if something happened at that job, it could be another 2 or 3 years before I found another one. In fact, I got laid off this week from one of my 3 current jobs for budgeting reasons, and I haven't even bothered to start the applying process again because it just feels so pointless. And people like this who are selling coaching services might try and convince you that your approach is the issue. Unfortunately, it usually has nothing to do with you, which makes you feel even more helpless. Like when I finally managed to find jobs that were actually doing interviews, I would make it to the end round of candidates for those interviews. But the issue is right in front of you. When you open up your LinkedIn and you look at all your job applications, what do you see right away? Only one of them says that it was even viewed. And most of them just all go completely unviewed and untouched. And that's because most of these jobs aren't actually real. And I can confirm this now as someone who worked within a company and whose friend worked within a very large company we'll call Saline Forces. One day I noticed they had hundreds and hundreds of jobs listed on LinkedIn and I was like, oh, I should apply and come work with you, it would be fun. And he said, none of those jobs are probably real. We just keep posting the same jobs over and over again and most of them aren't even real so that it looks like we're constantly growing and doing well to people on the outside. And most companies do this. Even one of the companies I worked for did this. We would always have a couple jobs posted for our department just in case like the perfect Goldilocks person came along to fit it. But for the most part, it wasn't really a real job. They're referred to as ghost jobs, but there's no way of knowing at first glance which ones are real and which ones are fake. So they all go into counting to these numbers. That allegedly the job market has 1.4 positions posted for every person looking. I don't know why we're not cracking down more on that.
Okay, it's childish, can't be no homegirl, drop it like the NASDAQ. Move white girls like it's coke up my ass crack. Move black girls, cause man, fuck it, I'll do either. I love pussy, I love bitches, dude, I should be running Peter in Adidas with some short shorts. B-O-O all over me, my green is where it's supposed to be. Your green is in my grocery, this Asian dude, I stole his girl. And now he got that Koji beef, my dick is like an accent mark. It's all about the overeat.
Oh ma douce souffrance, pourquoi s'acharner, tu recommences. Je ne suis qu'un être sans importance, sans lever je suis un peu paro. Je déambule seul dans le métro, une dernière danse pour oublier ma peine immense. Je veux m'enfuir que tout recommence.
Okay.
When you out yourself as an addict on the internet, you have to deal with the fact that people will come out of the woodworks to try and prove that you're not an addict, that you didn't experience that, that it wasn't that bad, and that you're being dramatic, because they are trying to make excuses for what their addiction has done to them, because they cannot accept the fact that they're an addict. I just found this comment thread under one of my videos where I'm talking about my addiction, where someone was like, yeah, I can tell she's just being dramatic. Like, she hasn't had it that bad because when you just do pills on the weekend, then you're not an addict. Like, if you just do pills every weekend, you're not an addict. And I'm thinking about that, like, so you have a schedule for when you use, you frequently use, you're abusing prescription drugs. That's what I assume you're implying with pills, but you're not an addict? So you're telling me, oh, I just black out Friday and Saturday night every single weekend. It's the one thing I look forward to. And I'm not an addict. Every single weekend I trip acid, I look forward to it. I make sure to pick up on time. I have a schedule. but I'm not an addict. Like, people don't understand that addiction is not just what you saw in Forrest Gump with Jenny and how she's shooting up and she's suicidal. There are functioning addicts everywhere. When I was at the peak of my addiction, I was still posting to this app every fucking day. Every day. And some of you guys could tell, and most of you guys could not. I was not sober in half of those videos. How would you have known, though? I just find it very funny because addicts are the ones that oftentimes perpetuate the stigma and the stereotypes that they complain about. Like, you are causing the problems for yourself. You just don't see it that way.
Well, my name is Brinsley McNamara, and welcome to Weird Ireland. Today I had no potatoes in the house, so I spun down to the potato vending machine to pick up 5 kilos.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching, and see you somewhere else in Weird Ireland.